Hi again, Michael.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going pretty well. We are ready to do our last lesson of this mini course on unsupervised learning and randomized optimization.
Cool. What's it about?
It is about feature transformation as opposed to feature selection.
Cool. So they can change from vehicles into robots, I assume.
Typically. Usually it's from robots into cars, but that's a technical detail.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm going to define feature transformation for you, or at least I'm going to do my best to. It turns out that it's a slightly more slippery definition than the one that we used for feature selection, but has a lot of things in common. Okay? And you tell me if this makes sense. Okay, so feature transformation, as opposed to feature selection, which we talked about last time, is the problem of doing some kind of pre-processing on a set of features in order to create a new set of features. Now, typically, we expect that new set of feature to be smaller or in some way more compact, okay? But while we create this new set of features, we want to explicitly retain as much information as possible. And when I say retain as much information as possible, I probably mean, I think we'll see as we continue this conversation, information that is relevant and hopefully useful. Now, the first thing you might ask is, what's the difference between this and feature selection? Is that a question you might ask, Michael?
I was thinking about that, though I think you kind of told me at the beginning of the feature selection lecture.
Well, I told you that I was going to tell you. I'm not sure I actually told you. So one thing you might say, Michael, is that if I looked at this definition, this seems to actually be consistent with feature selection as well. I take a set of features in feature selection, then I create a new feature set, which happens to be smaller. And my goal was to retain as much information as possible. And we talked about the difference between relevant features and useful features, but really, this sort of describes feature selection as well. You see that?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, now the difference is, in fact, probably the right way to think about this is that feature selection is, in fact, a subset of feature transformation, where the pre-processing you're doing is literally taking a subset of the features. Here, feature transformation can be more powerful and can be an arbitrary pre-processing, not just something that goes from a set to a subset. But what we're going to do is we're going to restrict our notion of feature transformation to what's called linear feature transformation. So let me define that for you explicitly. So as before with the feature subset, we said that we were taking a bunch of features or a bunch of instances that were in some n-dimensional feature space and transforming it into another feature space of size m. And in the feature selection problem, m was meant to be less than n, hopefully much less than n. And that's typically the case in feature transformation, though, as we'll discuss towards the very end, it doesn't have to be. But when I say usually we expect m to be less than n, usually means almost always.
Okay.
And that's because of the curse of dimensionality problem. But the difference between what we were doing with feature selection and feature transformation, because this is exactly what I wrote before, is that this transformation operator is usually something like this, a linear transformation operator. So the goal here is to find some matrix P such that I can project my examples, my points in my instance space, into this new subspace, typically smaller than the original subspace. And I'll get some set of new features, which are combinations, and in particular, linear combinations of the old features. Does that make sense?
I think so. So then that P matrix would want to be N by M.
Yes.
So the transpose would be M by N, and that multiplies by the N-dimensional feature space in X and projects it out to an M-dimensional feature space.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, good. So if we wanted to write that out, we could say that feature selection was about taking features like x1, x2, x3, and x4, and finding a subset like x1 and x2, and that would be feature selection. But feature transformation would be taking something like x1, x2, x3, and x4, and translating into something like 2x1 plus x2. Which creates a single new feature, which is a linear combination of a subset of those. Does that make sense?
Yeah, but it could actually make other feature combinations as well, right? So
Right.
just project it down to one.
Right. It could be projected down to two, or it could be projected down to three, or it could even project it down to a different four.
Okay.
And in principle, you could imagine that you could even project up into other dimensions, which is something that we've done before, conceptually anyway.
When we talked about kernels?
Yeah, although those were typically nonlinear transformations. implicit in the notion was doing a nonlinear feature transformation. But we did it even before we learned about kernels. The very second thing I think we did.
Perceptrons? How did perceptrons go into a higher dimensional space?
Well, when we talked about XOR.
Oh, right.
What we effectively did is we showed that we could project the original two-dimensional space into what looks like a three-dimensional space, where the third dimension was a combination of the first two. And then you could actually do it with a linear separator.
Ah, but that wasn't a linear transformation. That C was a nonlinear transformation.
Right, because we're talking about Boolean variables.
Yeah.
But in the end of the day, it was still a kind of feature transformation. And in this case, a feature transformation where we went to a higher number of features. And today, what we're going to be talking about is linear transformations as opposed to nonlinear transformations. And we're going to be focusing specifically on the case where we're trying to reduce the number of dimensions. So the implicit assumption here, right, the kind of domain knowledge that we're bringing to here, or the belief that we're bringing here, is that we don't need all n features. We need a much smaller set of features that'll still capture all the original information and therefore help us to overcome the curse of dimensionality. It's just that that smaller subset might require bringing in information across the various features. Okay?
Yeah.
All right.